That's it to rain, pages 263. Joseph Prince wrote, "I can't understand why many believers are still trying to balance law and grace. If you are for the law, be for the law completely. If you are for grace, then be for grace completely. It is impossible to balance the two of them." The Lord was saying that He would the church be cold, entirely under law, or hot, entirely under grace. You see, if you were at least completely under law, it will lead you to despair and into the saving arms of Jesus. The law will unveil to you your sinfulness and inability to keep the full measure of it, and this will cause you to see your need for His grace. But when you have mixture, where you believe in grace but still hold on to the law, you neutralize the convicting power of the law to bring you to the end of yourself, so that you will cry out for the grace of the Savior. That is why you cannot be cold and hot at the same time, or be for both law and grace at the same time. The moment you attempt to balance grace with the law, you neutralize both, and each covenant is robbed of its full effect in your life. You become lukewarm because of the mixture, and God hates mixture because it robs you of the power to reign in life through the abundance of His grace. You cannot put new wine into old wineskins. You will lose both.
Okay, as I said, in 2000, I would say even 2000 years of church history, I don't find any evangelical scholar ever interpret in this way.
Not greedy, always one more million, one more million, one more million, all right? No, no, no. that can destroy you. Amen. And God loves you too much. So some of you wonder why God, no problem with you. Just your little finger just stop. Oh, I become a multi-billionaire. Amen. No problem for you. Why you let all these other billionaires and all that? Why not me? I'm a Christian one. Right? You ever thought of that way? Yeah, you know why? Because He loves you more. He loves you more because He knows that right now at this level, okay, you don't even tithe. Don't tithe. Don't. Because it's not a revelation. No use. If you tithe also, no use. It profits you nothing. All right? God wants you to have a revelation. Lord, I don't forget you. You're the first one. 10% goes to you. Now, which senior partner asked for 10%? But he says 10%. Okay? But some people, some Christians say, well, what I have, all everything belongs to God. It's like a man telling his wife. The wife says, I just want you to spend at least 1 week uninterrupted with me. Can or not? He says, darling, when I married you, don't understand. My whole life is yours. Does she buy it? Does she buy it? It's a wonderful excuse. All my money is the Lord. Amen? Why you let all these other billionaires and all that? Why not me? I'm a Christian one. Right? You ever thought of that way? Yeah. You know why? Because He loves you more. He loves you more because He knows that right now at this level, okay, you don't even tithe. Don't tithe. Don't. Because it's not a revelation. No use. If you tithe also, no use. It profits you nothing. All right? God wants you to have a revelation. Now, which senior partner asked for 10%? But he says 10%. Okay? But some people, some Christians say, well, what I have, all everything belongs to God. It's like a man telling his wife. The wife says, I just want you to spend at least 1 week uninterrupted with me. Can or not? He says, darling, when I married you, don't understand. My whole life is yours. Does she buy it? Does she buy it? It's a wonderful excuse. All my money is the Lord. Amen?
Because if you don't remind yourself everything you have belongs to the Lord, you will be in trouble. Everything belongs to God. So whatever you do with your money, I want you to know something. It's God's money.
I have never preached tithing in my life. I've preached giving. Because in the New Testament, we're to give out of gratitude. And the Lord doesn't want your gift if you don't want to give it. But in the Old Testament, they had to tithe. practice, not a Christian practice, but it was a Jewish practice. And my wife and I sat and listened to a young man in a church preaching on tithing. And he said to the congregation, if you don't tithe, your grandchildren and great-grandchildren will suffer, because the law says to the third and fourth generation. He said, you'll be under the curse and you'll put your grandchildren under the curse. Do you want to do that? Then let's take up the offering for this morning. And they got the biggest offering I think they had for years. But I said afterwards to the leaders of that church, that was wicked teaching. And it makes people give out of fear, but the Lord loves a cheerful giver under the new covenant. And frankly, churches that are taught giving give far more than tithing. For some people, tithing would be far too little. And for others, it would be far too much. And we need to be much more flexible.
The one we are exempt from is the old covenant which was made with Moses. If your church insists on you tithing, they have put you straight back under the old covenant.
Don't hit people over the head with it as a requirement under the law, because there is no New Testament requirement for the tithe. Let me say it again. There is not a New Testament requirement for tithe. Rather, as we'll see, there is a principle, and the principle calls for generosity, and the principle calls for support of those who are in ministry. As Paul wrote in 1 Corinthians 9, those who preach the gospel should make their living by the gospel. These are taught in the New Testament, but the specific tithe command is not taught. Let me say it again. The principle of generosity is taught. The principle of supporting those that minister to you spiritually, that is taught. But the specific requirement of the tithe is not taught. Are Christians required to tithe under the New Testament? No, they're not required to tithe, but as we go through the New Testament, we see that the New Testament encourages systematic giving. It encourages proportional giving. In other words, as you have, you're able to give. It encourages generous and even sacrificially generous giving at certain times. And it does call for those who are ministered to spiritually to sow back in naturally to support those who minister to them. Now, I've said that Malachi 3 is not a legal thing over us today, because we're not under the Sinai covenant, that you're under a curse if you don't tithe, and if you tithe, you'll be out from under the curse. But there are principles of generosity there that God will honor.
You'd be surprised to know that in the New Testament, there is no command in the New Testament for Christians who are Gentiles, who are not Jews, to tithe. But some pastors are very inconsistent here, and I think that they're being driven by fear about them, their own paycheck, fear about their church, and maybe their love for ministry. They realize that if, you know, only 8% of our church even tithes, if you go out telling them they don't have to, we're going to end up closing our doors and this ministry is going to end. And I get that. Your church is being, perhaps your church is just being greedy and selfish with their money, but a 10% rule is not the fix. It's not the fix. Nowhere in the New Testament is tithing affirmed for Christians, you know, who are not under the law. I think 10% is not required. Giving is absolutely something I'm supposed to do as a Christian, local fellowship and beyond. And I'm not going to limit that to 10%. But that is not required. There's no New Testament teaching that's required. How do pastors that are so good at verse-by-verse teaching get all weird on tithing? I don't understand. Are we told, however, to give and support those who minister to us spiritually? Yes. Is there an amount associated with that? No. Because in the body of Christ, people are in different situations with different amounts of money and all that. So it's just, you give how? Cheerfully. You give according to what you have decided in your own heart. 10% isn't that. Unless you've decided that, but no one can dump it on you.
So the New Testament text doesn't say that. Giving is something that we should do, right? I want to help the poor among us. I want to pay for the people who minister to me.
I would say we should value our riches in Christ in this new covenant relationship so highly, and our freedom from sin so highly, and our gospel so highly, that we would simply love to give. Jesus said it is more blessed to give than to receive, and we would be free from a love of things and a dependence on things, and we would outgive those who lived under the law, because we have a better covenant and a better promise. Everything is greater with Christ. Why wouldn't giving be greater? I think the gist of it was, brothers and sisters, why would we want to do less? I mean, why? The person who's saying, do I have to, they're getting off on the wrong foot immediately. Everything is greater in the new covenant. We have better promises, a better covenant, Hebrews says. Why wouldn't there be better sacrifice, better giving?
I assume you're not promoting a prosperity gospel in that explanation, or are you?
No. All I'm saying is the Lord has promised to bless the faithful giver. And I think one of the reasons the Lord blesses the faithful giver is because a faithful giver being blessed is able to give more. It's not an indulgent kind of thing. There are no guarantees, however, that you're going to be rich at all. The prosperity gospel is a deception. It's a pyramid. You know, it's a scheme. It's a con job that makes the people at the top very, very rich.
Are these silly, charismatic prosperity preachers who have their hand out? You notice some of you need to hear this, because sooner or later they find out the only one getting rich is the preacher.